I've been asked before we start, taking a few minutes to encourage one another with songs. If you want to check your cell phone, make sure it's down. We'll have a great day together. So we're gonna sing for a little while. 514, if you can find the songbook. 514. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through His infinite mercy. His child and forever I am. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. Redeemed and so happy in Jesus. No language my rapture can tell. I know that the light of His presence with me doth continually dwell. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. I know I shall see in His beauty the King in whose law I delight, who lovingly guardeth my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night. Redeemed, redeemed, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, redeemed, His child and forever I am. 417, 417. Sweet are the promises, kind is the word, dearer far than any message man ever heard. Pure was the mind of Christ, sinless I see. He the great example is and pattern for me. Where He leads, I follow, follow all the way.
Hallelujah, what a Savior.
867. 2 Canaan's land, I'm on my way where the soul never dies. My darkest night will turn to day where the soul never dies. No sad farewells, no tears. With the 650, send the light, 650. There's a call comes ringing o'er the restless wakes in the light, send the light. There are souls to rescue, there are souls to save, send the light, send the light, send the light, the blessed gospel light, let it shine from shore to shore, send the light. Song 909. There's a fountain free, 'tis for you and me. Let us haste, all haste to his brink. 'Tis the fount of love from the source above, and he bids us all freely drink. Will you come? Let us hasten, joy.
Let's pray. Father in heaven, Lord, we do praise your great name. Truly, Lord, as the scripture says and as the song we just sung says, the Spirit and the bride say, come. Father, your plan is amazing from the very beginning. When you said it is not good for man to be alone. Lord, that is true. Here in our life, as we go through, you designed us to be partners, to have one who we walk side by side with. And Lord, all of that we understand is even bigger to communicate to us that it's not good for us to be alone apart from you. And that, Father, you yourself truly desire fellowship. You desire partnership. You desire the bride to walk with you. We just ask, Lord, your blessing on this day, on this ceremony, on Jay and Katie and their new life together. Lord, may you be glorified, not only through this day, but from here and forward. It is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
I just wanted to take this time, Katie and I together, to thank you for coming. A lot of times at receptions we don't get a chance to thank you, so up front, just everybody appreciate it. You know, for Ben, Holly, Cindy, Leanne, we're very thankful also that in ways you can be part of this. So we're very thankful, and just our hearts are so full of love and everything at this point. We just love you all. And don't know how long that'll keep going, but we do.
Well, I'm sure you've already realized this, but this is no ordinary way. Personally, I like that. You know, I'm sure there is going to be a receiving line afterwards, but I like that the greeting coming in. That's the way the Lord is, isn't it? You know, the Spirit and the bride do say come. And I just want to tell you both, I'm super honored to have a part of this and to share with you today. You know, Dad, I've known you as long as I've been alive. And in all seriousness, you are the most spiritual man I've ever known. You're a great man. You're the greatest man I've ever known. Got to meet a guy in Billings here a few weeks ago, and didn't know him. And I met him, and he asked me if I was related to you. He kind of knew going in, but as we talked, he said, your dad is the greatest guy, greatest man I've ever known. And not even a part of the church. I was like, that's true. That's true. And, you know, you love God. You love God, and you've committed your life completely, completely to him. And along the way, because of your love for God, you know, you love souls. You love me. You love our family. You've supported us all of our life. You love this family. And we are all happy. We're all happy to be here in support of you today. And I gotta say, it's really nice to see you happy with someone you love. I think Scott Schweitzer took a picture here of you two a couple weeks ago, and it was going around, and I noticed it's on your Facebook profile, which is nice. But, you know, I noticed Dad talking with you, just chatting with you, The last little while, there's been a little more cheer in your voice. And I noticed that picture, and I was like, man, I haven't seen you smile like that for a long time. And you always smile. But that smile was a smile with your eyes, a smile with your heart. And I was glad to see that. Katie, I don't know you quite as well, but I've still known you a long time. I remember in college, right after I graduated from college, I came out to Oregon, and you took me into your house and let me stay there for a while. I was doing some things, and I got to be honest, you're the most spiritual woman I know. You know, throughout all those years, you've always been a great encouragement to me personally. You've been gone out of your way to every time I preach a message and you're there, you've always been there to tell me what a great message it was, even when a few times I knew it really wasn't. But you said I did good. You know, you're so invested in the kingdom. And you two are a perfect match. I had no doubt about that. You know, it's amazing. The man plans his ways, and the Lord directs his steps. Lots of times just a gentle steering, and sometimes a hard right or a hard left. But the Lord knows what he's doing. And he has brought you two together this day. I don't think I need to tell you this, but as long as we're on it, what God's joined together, let no man separate, right? I got to be honest, though. I warned my dad, and just being a... Not about you, per se. I mean, it was, but at the time I didn't know it was about you. Okay, so, but just being friends in the last few years and talking to, you know, how you doing, Dad? And, you know, just talking with him and you know, knowing he was a little bit lonely. But my concern with him, I was like, Dad, you know, and he wasn't expressing interest or a find in anybody, but I know he was looking. I know he already had somebody in mind, you know, come to find out now. But you know, I told him, I was like, Dad, the one thing I'm concerned about is you're so busy. You have so much that you do and for the Lord. And when, you know, women, they want to be loved and they want someone to give special attention to them, spend special time with them. I said, I'm just worried that whether or not you'd ever be able to do that. And in our conversations, you know, one of the things I say, it'd have to be somebody who cared about the same things you care about. Somebody who's as into the kingdom as you are. Somebody who would enjoy doing things with you. And I'm honest, Katie, I do not matchmake. But I walked out of that last conversation we had, and there was one person in my mind, and I did not mention your name. But you are the only person that I thought this could ever work with, because you care about the same stuff. You guys love the Lord and you love serving him, and I can see you love serving him together. So I'm super, super happy for you guys. But you know, I gotta warn you about a couple things. It's probably just a little late. You haven't said I do yet. I'll tell you, none of us will think any of the less of you. But, you know, my dad, in case you didn't know this, but now he's pretty definite. When the cars head to Great Falls, they're going. If this is the way, and he'll hear you out, but if this is the way we're going to do it, this is the way we're going to do it. You know that about my dad. And, you know, he's not the kind of guy who's going to take you out on a little coffee date. Although he did come and take you to lunch a few, so you know he's doing good. But he just, guys put their best foot forward before they get married. I'm just telling. Coffee dates are probably not in the picture. And on Saturday mornings, you know, sleeping in and chatting a little bit, not gonna happen. He hits the ground, those feet are running, but you know, when you go with him on his trips, he'll be happy to buy you a hot dog with him. He'd be happy to pay. Hey, whatever you want. I'm just wondering. Yeah, in all reality, the Lord's brought you together. The logistics are going to be fun, and you guys are spiritually mature, and you guys will figure that out and work it out. But I am confident that you two will be a great team for the kingdom. Okay. So Mark's coming up here to preach a little bit, and I got to be honest, We talked about what we were going to do, and he didn't care, and I didn't really care, but I took this part. Because I don't know what he's going to say to you. I mean, you guys have thousands and thousands and thousands of hours of marriage counseling that you've given. And you, about the same, what's he going to tell you? I know there's some things that really it's for the benefit of us all. And that's why that's what I love about both of you. You care about the church. You care. This day is about you. But much more than that, I know both of you, you want to be about the Lord. And you want to be about his church. And so I know Mark will preach some stuff that's good for all of us, including you two. And I hope he pushes you both a little bit, too, while he's up here. But I just want to tell you both, I'm super happy and I'm excited for you two both in your love for the Lord and love for each other to go do this together. Brother Mark.
Yeah. There's a problem having too many preachers in one family. Everybody wants a shot at you, so. But I am really excited to be here today. Just really, really glad to be here. But, you know, like Luke was saying, this really is a singular event. It's a little surreal, but something like this is only going to happen really once. And, you know, watching all of you guys pour through the door, I've never seen a wedding like this ever. I mean, everybody's having a great time. And we haven't even hit the cake yet. I mean, everybody is. because you guys have made such a huge difference in all of these lives. And, you know, for me personally, you know, there really isn't any other people who've made greater spiritual impact on my life than the two of you. But it is appropriate for us this afternoon to discuss a little bit about the scriptures and to take the opportunity. Here she comes, boys. To take the opportunity to really glorify the Lord and his word. So let's do that. As I was thinking about some things and what would be appropriate in this particular setting, I was thinking about a particular love story out of the Old Testament that caught my attention, and it's one that I think is apt for us this afternoon. I was looking in Ruth, and if you guys know the story of Ruth, Ruth is this Moabite gal who gets picked up by an Israelite fella, and ends up back in Israel sometime after. Runs into a man named Boaz, and through some chicanery. The two of them get together, but I wanted you to take note of what really caused them to find one another in that circumstance. Boaz is the first to really notice Ruth. He says several things about her in chapter 2, verse 12. He finds these things in Ruth. He says, Ruth, you know, you really are exceptional. He says, this gal has worked really, really hard for Naomi, okay, part of her family. And Boaz took notice not only of her hard work, but also of her devotion. And he recognized in Ruth that she really was somebody special. He also recognized that she really had a strong trust in the Lord. He said, the way he described it, he said, you know, you've put yourself in the care, kind of under his wings. He said, and Boaz noticed that about Ruth. I mean, for a foreign gal to make that kind of commitment to a family and a God that wasn't hers initially, Boaz noticed that, and he said, this is something he really valued. He found that attractive. And, you know, I'll say what Luke says. You know, I don't really know anybody quite like Mom. She really is a singular woman. The this would be a couple years ago now. She told me, one of the things I'm going to miss is Mom likes to get around and travel a little bit, so she's perfect for you. But when I'd make my trips to Spokane in the afternoon, Mom would ride along pretty regularly. And so, you know, we get a nice chance to chat back and forth and talk about this and that. So, you know, we talk occasionally about, well, what do you want to do now? And Mom says to me, she says, well, she says, I want to do something big. She says, I want to do something big. She tells me, you know, at this stage of life, she says it's real easy to want to kind of coast to the finish line. She said, I don't want to do that. She said, I want to do something big. And lately, she said, I feel like my best work is ahead of me. She did. If Mom's afraid of anything, it's afraid of going out quietly. Boaz noticed in Ruth chapter 3, in verse 11, he said, now, my daughter, do not fear. I will do for you whatever you ask. All the people in the city know you are a woman of excellence. Ruth noticed Boaz in return. She noticed in chapter 2 that he'd become a comfort to her. Noticed that he'd shown kindness to her. That he didn't have to, wasn't compelled to do that by law or otherwise. But Boaz went out of his way to love her. And Ruth, you know, she took note, didn't she? And I was surprised when we got home one day, Jennifer and I did, and Kimberly said, Dad, guess who was here? I don't know. Who? You'll never guess. Well, how about we just get to the part where you tell me then? Mr. Wilson was here, and he took Grandma on a date. Come again, sweetheart? Now I know it was just lunch. But you went out of your way to show her kindness and that you cared about her and comfort her. And she noticed. And I know about you that when the two of you walk down the red carpet, it's not going to be into the sunset. Yeah. If there's light at the end of that tunnel, it's a blaze of glory. Well, Ruth and Boaz are a pretty good reflection of the couple today, in so much as they're really a great reflection of Christ and his church. And the story of Ruth is really the story of the church and the story of Jesus, just told in ancient Israel. And the Lord chose, like Luke was talking about, the Lord chose that he wanted someone to be with him, to go with him, to be a part of what he's doing. The Lord wanted a helpmate. And he chose the church. He chose this, you know, foreign gal who trusted him, believed in him, loved him, based on the love that and the kindness he had shown to her. It's a great picture of Christ in the church and the overtures that God makes toward mankind. We would be remiss, you know, in a crowd this size, not to mention the fact that God wants that relationship with you. God wants you to be a partner in the gospel message. Not a slave, not a servant, but a partner. So I've called you friends. And that's something I appreciate so much about the two of you, is you guys are really good friends. God wants that kind of relationship. And every time we sit down and we talk about man and wife, it causes us to stop and think for a moment that God still wants that relationship. And if today, if you'd like to be a partner with the Lord in the gospel message, there's lots of guys you can chat with who can set you straight and help you, you know, sort through that and kind of sort out the logistics of understanding who Jesus is and growing in that relationship and ultimately being immersed into Christ. But this, I mean, God set it up this way, so we have to stop and think about it ever so often. But what a tremendous blessing we have today to be able to watch and participate with you guys and give you our best send-off. I'm thankful we get to swap rings instead of shoes like they did in Boaz Day. So, yeah. In Ruth chapter 4, and we'll finish up here, he says in verse 11, Boaz, he wastes no time. And heads to the city gates, grabs 10 elders or so, and says, sit down here. We have business to conduct. He says, there's the guy I need to see right now. Comes in, right, says, okay, everybody's all here. All the witnesses are in place. He says, are there any objections? I marry this girl. Well, that's my loose paraphrase. That's like the amplified message, you know, version according to Mark. And after they take care of that, the deal is done. He says, I've acquired Ruth the Moabitess, and so on. But in verse 11, all the people who are in the court and the elders said, we are witnesses. Now, that'd be us today. Now, here we are, all the witnesses, right? Some of us elder, right? Gathered in the court. We are witnesses to what goes on today. And they said, may the Lord make the woman who is coming into your home like Rachel and Leah, both of whom built the house of Israel. And may you achieve wealth in Ephrathah and become famous in Bethlehem. Build the house of Israel. All of us are witnesses. We're all here, not only to witness the event, but to encourage you to build the house of Israel. Build it! I am happy to say that the old Raz Sawyer story has a happy ending. It's appropriate that we should pray. Great and glorious Father in heaven, Lord, to you we give all the praise. Father, what a tremendous blessing you have afforded us this afternoon to be able to participate, to rejoice together, Father, with these two as they show us a tremendous picture of Christ in the church, and to be able to reflect back some of the tremendous joy that they have given to us. Father, we're grateful to be able to be a part of each other's lives, and in the body of Christ, what a blessing it is to be joined together as one body, as one family. Father, we're grateful for the time we get to spend together. Lord, we pray that you would make this woman and this man fruitful in the house of Israel, that they would be like those who built it. We pray, Father, that what you have brought together would produce wonderful things, and that the kingdom of heaven would be built up and glorified, and that Jesus Christ would be exalted through their work, through their lives, through their deaths, however you decide. Father, we are witnesses today of those things. We ask in Jesus' name, amen. My buddy Mark Harrington said in Missoula, as only Mark Harrington can say, "Whew, devil got his hands full now."
You don't get to do those quite yet. This guy doesn't waste time. You know, at the very end, Mark mentioned Raz Sawyer. I was just curious how many people here, I don't think people listen usually when they get married. Maybe they do, but how many people here remember that story being told when they got married? Well, my brother Matt wanted to make sure that I did razz you a little bit and remind you to make sure you're the best pals in the whole world. And I know you got your own vows, and you're going to get to do those, but I did want to make sure it'd only be fitting if I ask you a question before you say those. And that is, do you take this woman? Not a woman of your imagination, but this woman before you today. And the same for you. This man, we're witnesses. This man, not a man of your imagination, but this guy, right? All right, you guys can do the real ones. So do you need to borrow the mic?
Katie, my love, I promise with all that's in me to love you as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her. I promise to live with you in an understanding manner as with a weaker vessel, grant you honor as a fellow heir of the grace of life. And all that the scripture says about that. Choked up. So, in language that I think you'll understand and appreciate, in the sight of men, the sight of God, from this day hence, I plight thee my troth.
That's awesome. Would you hold your bouquet?
I'll let you do that.
No, he did really well. You see, I need a little help here. Gave a lot of thought to this. Mr. Thomas J. Wilson, Jr., I accept your invitation to be your lawful wedded wife, to be your helpmate, to work by your side in the Lord's vineyard, to help you reach your goals, to share and help fulfill your God-given purpose and your dreams. I promise to faithfully be your loving wife, to treat you as I would Jesus Christ, for in fact, that's who you represent. I pledge to you my life, my friendship, my respect, and my undying love.
With this ring, I pledge my vows to you. If you prefer, with this ring, I thee wed. I'm the best man.
With this ring, I pledge my vows to you, my love.
By the power vested in me by the state of Montana and Almighty God, I now pronounce you man and wife. You may kiss the bride. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we do thank you so much that you are God. Father, we're thankful for the love that we have because you first loved us. Lord, how wonderful it is, how amazing it is to understand true love, real love, because of you. How wonderful it is to see it demonstrated, of course, at the cross, and then to see it lived out in the lives of your people whom you have redeemed. Father, we just ask that you really would be with Jay and Katie, that you would lead them, that you would walk with them, Father, as they walk with you. And that through them, you would continue to build. Father, I know both of them. They don't want glory. They want you to have the glory. So Father, please be with them. Help them. And we thank you thankful, Lord, for the example already they've set for the rest of us, and ask that they would continue to do so, and that we would look to them and love and respect in our own marriages as you have asked us to do. Lord, may you be glorified. It is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen.
Amen.
May I introduce to you Mr. and Mrs. Jay Wilson.
And us around the
are we coming out that way to for them to receive us. So you are, yeah, we'll go in this order, I guess. Just go row by row. Follow me.
Thank you.